Tonight, a high-ranking party mate of Philippine President Duterte opposes the chief executive's endorsement of Senator Bongo as presidential candidate next year.
The Philippines' COVID fatality rate climbs to its highest level since April.
Police in Haiti clash with gunmen believed to be responsible for the death of President Jovenel Moise.
And authorities in Florida end their search for survivors from a collapsed building.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Karen Davila.
On our broadcast tonight, harsh words by a co-founder of the Philippines' dominant party against a potential election tandem of President Duterte and his longtime aide, Senator Christopher Bongo. Duterte's openness to his possible vice presidential bid also alarming a framer of the country's 1987 constitution. Sherrianne Torres has tonight's top story.
One of the founding members of the ruling PDP Laban Party opposes President Duterte's endorsement of Senator Christopher Bongo as his successor. Party Vice President for Eastern Visayas, Lutgardo Barbo, says he will question a possible Go-Duterte tandem for 2022 at the PDP Laban National Assembly meeting on July 16 and 17. Barbo asserts Go is not a party member, and Duterte does not have the monopoly of deciding for the party, even if he is the chairman.
We will also question the political wisdom, ano, at saka the right of the president to unilaterally select his president. Hindi lang nakakatawa, nakakahiya kung ang pipili ng kanyang president ay yung vice president. Does not mean that the chairman has the final say. Hindi tama yung sasabihin, well, I am the President of the Republic, I am the law, or I am above the law. That is wrong. Dictate on the PDP Laban.
While Go claims he is not interested in running for president, he said he is willing to run if the party has no other choice. Barbo wants his party mates to make their voices be heard.
I am going to ask some members to stand up for the political party because the political party is bigger than ourselves and much larger than our own selfish political ambitions. The political party should stay alive even if we are no longer around. You have to stand up and say, might does not make right.
One of the framers of the 1987 Constitution, lawyer Christian Monsod, says Duterte should not be allowed to run for vice president after his term.
Maliwanag na yung kanilang pinaplano is to enter the back door to the presidency. Kasi number one, tatakbo ng vice president. Tapos sabi nila siya pang pipili ng presidential candidate. Tapos aminom nga, baka yung anak niyang babae. So ano ang plano? Kasi bawal nga siya umupo ulit as president. Ito parang palusot, backdoor. Kung anak niya lalo yung anak niya yung kanyang presidente, di siya sasabihin lang niya, bumaba ka na, ako na magbibisident.
If Duterte will indeed run for vice president, Monson vows to question its legality.
Well, I'm sure somebody will file. And if nobody files, then I'll file.
Dr. Jean Franco of the University of the Philippines Political Science Department sees Mr. Duterte's running as an act of bastardizing the very essence of democracy.
Yung aim ng 1987 Constitution para i-rein in yung pagiging ganid o greedy sa kapangyarihan, no, na experience natin nung rehimeng Marcos, pero tila tinatalikuran ito ng President Administration.
Meanwhile, the palace defends the airing of the ruling party's meeting at state-run channel PTV4.
Ang alam ko po, whenever it's newsworthy, it's covered. Kasi kung hindi po, masuscoop naman sila. PTV is still a news agency. The president po has always been chairman of PDP Laban, and there's simply no way to separate the political personality of the president from his functions. Because halal nga po siya ng taong bayan, his position is principally political.
Sherrianne Torres, ABS-CBN News. A Philippine prelate critical of President Duterte's bloody anti-drug campaign is the new leader of the country's Catholic bishops. Caloocan Bishop Pablo Virgilio David is the new president of the Catholic Bishops Conference of the Philippines. David had received death threats after drawing Duterte's ire for denouncing the president's drug war. The bishop had strongly condemned the 2017 killing of 17-year-old Kian de los Santos, who was shot dead by Caloocan police while allegedly resisting arrest.
Active COVID cases declining in the Philippines, but the case fatality rate now at its highest since April. Rafael Bozano reports.
The Philippine government is seeing positive improvements in its COVID numbers, with a 1.76% case fatality rate, said to be the highest since April, is a cause for concern. ABS-CBN data analytics head Edson Guido says even if some areas are seeing a decreasing trend in infections, there are others which continue to grapple with COVID-19 surges, as well as high hospital and ICU utilization rates, making it difficult for some to seek proper medical attention. Another factor, according to Guido, could be the accessibility and availability of vaccines for the most vulnerable sector.
Kung titingnan natin yung vaccine data natin, less than 800,000 no, ang senior citizens na fully vaccinated. So, lumalabas, less than 10% pa lang ng ating mga senior citizens ang nabigyan na ng complete dose. Alamin natin, is it hesitancy among senior citizens or is it because of access? Kasi pwedeng willing naman yung mga seniors mabakunahan pero hindi sila marunong mag-register or hindi sila nakapunta sa mga vaccination sites.
If there's any good news, the number of active cases is going down, but it's not nearly enough.
Yung trend na nakikita natin, it's reversible anytime. Anytime pwede yan magbago, and at our current level, no, hindi pa rin talaga maganda na nasa 5,000 plus cases pa rin tayo. Kaya yung active cases natin, nasa 40 to 50,000 pa rin siya, pero nung pre-surge level natin earlier this year, nung nasa January to February tayo, nasa 20,000 lang siya. They have improved, pero mataas pa rin talaga yung mga numbers na nakikita natin.
In Southeast Asia, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, and the Philippines have recorded the highest average daily cases in the past week. But unlike its neighbors, which are seeing an upward trend, the Philippines has plateaued. What is worrisome is that the Philippines shares similarities with Indonesia, which is struggling to contain a spike in infections. For several months, Indonesia recorded some 5,000 cases, but this number has now ballooned after the spread of the more contagious Delta variant. Strict border controls have so far kept the problematic variant at bay, but it remains a persistent threat against gains in government's pandemic response. To help government from losing ground against COVID-19, getting vaccines to more people will help bring down COVID-related deaths, as seen in Malaysia and Thailand. While they are recording more cases, deaths remain low.
We could partially explain this also by the current percentage nga ng mga taong fully vaccinated na. Kasi if titingnan natin sa datos, ang Malaysia ay halos 9% na ng population nila fully vaccinated. Sa Thailand, it's at 4.4%. Sa Pilipinas, it's at 2.7%.
Rafael Bozano, ABS-CBN News.
Local governments in the Philippines attempt to resolve conflicting travel protocols with the country's pandemic officials. They've disagreed over who should dictate domestic travel requirements. More from Zandro Ochona.
Travel protocols remain a sticky point for government and local officials. The Interagency Task Force to End COVID-19 met with several local government units to resolve issues arising from its 124-B resolution, which allows fully vaccinated Filipinos to visit provinces without a negative RT-PCR test result. But the League of Provinces of the Philippines argues enforcing uniform guidelines for the whole country is counterproductive since each LGU deals with different situations on the ground.
Yung ano, testing na bago pumasok, discretion na po ng local chief executive yan. Maring marami na pong nabakunahan sa kanilang mga residents katulad po sa Baguio. Pero sa iba naman po na maliit pa lang yung porsyento ng nababakunahan para ma-attain po yung herd immunity, yan po yung mga may bibigyan ng discretion na mag-impose po ng testing requirement.
A former advisor to the IATF agrees.
Ang taas ng positivity rate natin, for the last 3 months, 12% pa. Ibig sabihin, ang degree of transmission of the disease ay mataas pa rin. So how can we be relaxed on these guidelines when the basic metrics of success are not being met?
For Baguio City, a top tourist destination, it will follow the resolution, but its testing protocols will be enforced for unvaccinated visitors.
Pwede pong dalhin yung mga bata, sila naman po ang kailangan mag-test kasi nga hindi pa sila naka-vaccine. So yung lahat ng mga hindi pa po fully vaccinated, sila po ang mag-undergo ng test. Dito sa Baguio, pwede sila magpa-test upon arrival. May antigen test tayo dito na 500 pesos.
Local executives have raised concerns over the new protocol since there is no verification process in place to validate legitimate vaccination documents. With previous incidents of tourists faking RT-PCR tests, Baguio City Mayor Benjamin Magalong says this could also happen with vaccination cards.
Kami kasi may checkpoint kami at meron pa kaming triage facility. Mas mabuti pa ho na dali nyo yung vaccination card na may QR code para ma-verify po kagad natin.
To prevent fraud, some LGUs like the City of Makati are putting security features on their vaccination cards. Aside from a unique QR code and watermark, the document can also be verified through the city's online portal.
Pupunta ko sa portal, lalagay ko pangalan niya, at lalabas na yun doon na kung fully vaccinated niya siya o hindi pa siya fully vaccinated o hindi pa siya vaccinated at all.
A similar vetting process is also in place in the cities of Pasay and Muntinlupa.
Ito ay naka-registered talaga at pwede rin pong gamitin yung aming magre-register sila doon sa pasayme.ph at kahit po sa cellphone po nila yon, sariling cellphone nila, makikita yung kanilang card.
Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
The remains of a young Air Force nurse who was among the casualties of Sunday's military plane crash in Sulu are flown to Manila Thursday evening. Her grief-stricken father earlier shared with ABS-CBN's Jeff Canoy his sorrow and regret over her untimely death. Here's that story.
Every time she would fly back for work, retired Colonel Wilfredo Tato would often film his daughter, Lieutenant Sheena Alexandria Tato, at the airport. She hasn't even left, but already he's excited for her next visit.
Doon na yun, si Ria, yung anak kong babae, no, na military nurse.
Which is why it was a shock for the retired officer to receive news that the only thing that would be coming home are the remains of her daughter. The younger Tato, a Philippine Air Force nurse, is one of the 52 fatalities of the C-130 plane that crashed in Patikul, Sulu last July 4.
Bigla na tumawag yung boyfriend niya, si Patrick, sa kamalas dos. Sabi niya, siya nabalitaan mo na ba ang alin? Yung sinasakyan ni Ria na crash. Tolero kami ngayon lahat, natutolero. Natutuliro kami, na-shock ako, ayoko maniwala. Sabi ko sa kapatid, hindi ako maniniwala dyan, hindi official communication, ganun. So ganun ang nangyari. Para kumbuang, no, napasigaw-sigaw.
Rhea, as she was fondly called by her family, grew up in a military camp in Pagadian, where her father worked. She dreamt of becoming a doctor and entered the military as a nurse while she and her family saved up for further studies.
Kung sinabi mo gusto mo mag-medicine, at dahil sa katayuan natin na hindi ko makaya, sayang anak, kung ngayon sana iyon, kahit 10 beses ka na mag-aral sa medisina, dahil ang katayuan natin ay nagbago. Nung sinabi mo sa nanay mo, Nay, Ma, sana makabili tayo nito hapag may pira na kayo. Ano ba yung bagay na iyon na sinasabi niya? Ang makabili ng Starbucks coffee doon sa mall.
Rhea was with her family last June. And according to her father, they spent a lot of time together during her training and preparation before joining the AFP. He says he was the one who suggested she join the service, but he didn't expect that she would be on the field as a nurse.
I have to confess that personally. Hindi ko na foresight na hindi ko na porsyat ang pagka, naabot ko lang na Syria ay sa hospital. Hindi ko na porsyat yung pagiging flight nurse. Na kung saan ang flight nurse ay nasa bingit ng kamatayan ang isang nilang paa. Hindi ko na porsyat. Kaya sinisisi ko ang aking sarili. Sinisisi ko, wala akong ibang sinisisi kundi ang aking sarili dahil sa sobra akong pagmamahal sa aking anak. Pag sobra akong pagmamahal sa aking anak na siya namang nagmahal ng gusto sa kanyang sinumpaang tungkulin bilang isang nurse, flight nurse o miyembro na ang forces of the Philippines. Tinupad niya. At yun ang nangyari.
During the necrological service at Villamor Air Base for Rhea, friends and family gathered to remember her as someone who loved her family and country. Mourners also thanked her father for sharing his daughter to the service. Jeff Canoy, ABS-CBN News.
Here are live pictures now from the Villamor Air Base in Pasay City, where Philippine President Duterte is personally welcoming the delivery of 1 million AstraZeneca doses. These are donated COVID vaccines from the Japanese government. Philippine vaccine czar Carlito Galvez says the AstraZeneca doses are to be sent to areas with a high number of COVID cases. Around 2 million doses of AstraZeneca vaccines and more than 100,000 Sputnik V doses will arrive in the Philippines Friday. Many cities have stopped inoculation, citing a shortage in vaccines.
The Philippine Labor Chief's proposal to scrap professional licensure exams getting stiff pushback from the country's Chief Justice. Labor Secretary Silvestre Bello believes the college training and exams of nursing and law students are sufficient to enable them to already practice their chosen fields. But Chief Justice Alexander Gismundo insists bar exams are indispensable.
I think we should maintain the bar examinations so that we can sift those who are competent considering the nature of the legal profession. The legal profession is vested with public interest.
Nurses groups say licensure exams for their profession should be retained. The group Filipino Nurses United warned that scrapping the tests could endanger public health. The Philippine Nurses Association points out that the main issue that needs to be addressed are the benefits paid to the country's nurses.
Veteran journalist and former chair of the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines, Nonoy Espina, has passed away. He was 59. Espina died of liver cancer Wednesday evening. His sister, Inday Espina Varona, said Nonoy survived a severe COVID infection and was able to return to his family before his death. In its tribute, the NUJP described Espina as a tireless champion for the freedom of the press from the Marcos dictatorship up until the Duterte administration. The group remembers how he sought justice for the victims of the Maguindanao massacre in 2009 and also fought for the renewal of the ABS-CBN franchise. On Friday, the NUJP will hold an online forum commemorating the first year since the House of Representatives denied the network's franchise application. Up ahead, Haiti under a state of emergency as authorities clash with the killers of the late Haitian President Jovenel Moise.
And the 31st Southeast Asian Games postponed due to the pandemic. The World Tonight returns after the break.
Back on the World Tonight, security forces in Haiti locked in a gun battle with the assassins of President Jovenel Moise. Police say four of the suspects have been killed while two are in custody. Haiti's envoy to the U.S. says the assassins posed as agents of the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration when they stormed Moise's home. A 2-week state of emergency has been declared to prevent other suspects from escaping the country. With President Moi's dead, he's supposed to be replaced by the Supreme Court's Chief Justice, but the magistrate recently died due to COVID-19, leaving the interim Prime Minister Claude Joseph in charge of the country.
There will be no spectators allowed at the Tokyo Olympics due to the rising number of COVID-19 infections in Japan's capital. Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga earlier declared a COVID-19 state of emergency over the capital. This will last until August 22, meaning the Olympics will be held amid tougher COVID restrictions.
China's Sinovac vaccine under scrutiny after a lead scientist of its trials in Indonesia dies of suspected COVID-19. The full story and more in this report.
The scientist leading Sinovac's vaccine trials in Indonesia dies of a suspected case of COVID-19. The infection and deaths of more than 100 health workers in the country who received the Chinese-made jab has prompted questions over its effectiveness in preventing COVID infections. Indonesia reported 852 new COVID-19 fatalities Thursday, as well as a record 38,391 new cases. Over in Brazil, a former health ministry official is arrested at the Senate. Roberto Diaz allegedly lied in his testimony to lawmakers investigating President Jair Bolsonaro's COVID-19 response. Diaz is accused of asking for bribes in government's procurement of vaccines. The scandal has damaged the popularity of Bolsonaro, who belittled both vaccines and the pandemic. The Southeast Asian Games will not be held this year due to COVID-19. The Olympic Council of Malaysia made the announcement Thursday, saying no new date has been decided yet. Philippine Olympic Committee President Abraham Tolentino also confirmed the postponement. The 31st SEA Games were supposed to be held between November 21st and December 2nd in Vietnam.
Tropical storm Elsa batters Florida, leaving at least one person dead. Tens of thousands of residents are still without power. The state has expanded its emergency declaration to include 33 counties hit by the storm. Elsa is expected to hit the U.S. East Coast by Friday. Meanwhile, more bodies were recovered from the collapsed building in Miami. The death toll now stands at 54 after 18 more bodies were pulled out of the rubble. But rescue officials have called off their search for survivors, saying there was no more hope of pulling out anyone alive from the ruins. Dozens of people remain missing.
Philippine shares close in the red for a third straight day, joining the downturn seen across regional markets. But one analyst still sees a lot of upside for the local birds. Michelle Ong reports.
Another step back for Philippine shares, joining several Asian markets fall amid a stimulus tapering debate and persistent COVID-19 woes. Global COVID-19 deaths breaching the 4 million mark, with India overtaking the U.S. and U.K. The whole world racing to vaccinate amid the spread of new variants. For the day, the PSE index slipped 0.25% to close at 69.24, with decliners beating advancers 119-82. For Sun Life Financial's Mike Enriquez, beyond the daily swings, there is still a lot of upside for the market, because not all good news has been priced in yet.
We need flows to come in first. But before flows to come in, we need to have some fundamental reason for the market to move higher. Well, at this point, we're just on the junction of waiting for second quarter earnings or the first half earnings results. But then again, there's also that noise or threat of the new variants coming in, lower supplies of vaccine. So those are the mixed signals.
In corporate stories, Jollibee Foods is partnering with Double Dragon and its industrial leasing subsidiary, Central Hub Industrial Centers, for what could be the country's largest landlord of industrial warehouses and the Philippines' first industrial REIT. Jollibee will acquire 3.97 billion pesos worth of Central Hub shares and in exchange will inject its 16.4 hectares of industrial properties currently used for its commissaries and 1.9 billion in cash investments. This will boost Central Hub's total industrial land portfolio to 39.8 hectares. Central Hub Industrial Centers plans to eventually register and operate as a REIT and debut in 2022. Jollibee says this is a more cost-effective way of financing and will allow it to focus on its core business. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Samuel Johnson. Every man wishes to be wise, and they who cannot be wise are almost always cunning.
And that is The World Tonight, the 8th of July, 2021. I'm Karen Davila.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!